Hello, welcome to another edition of Tackle Talk. As usual, five products and we're going to run the rule over them and see what you think. So Dan, seems like an age since we've done this. Look at it.
It's been a while. Yeah, we've bypassed summer. We've gone all the way through to shorts and Crocs weather. Height of fashion here. What do you reckon?
You see, we're giving people tackle reviews and weather reports at
fashion
the same time.
Fashion advice at the same time.
All the time. You're getting a lot. Absorb this, soak it, enjoy it. But I've got three products. You've got two, so that means I go first. Again? I always do this.
Go for it.
What we're going to go with first, I'm going to go with a product that we obviously were very fortunate to get a lot of tackle to try out with. And, you know, some of it we integrate into our fishing, some of it we don't. This is one thing that I've started to use myself because I think it is absolutely brilliant. It's a brand new landing net handle from Daiwa. It's the, they call it the D-Vec, the Daiwa D-Vec, and it's 3.8 meter landing net.
Yeah.
Put together, threads on each end. Now, the thing with a cheap landing net handle is, I think we had a discussion before about it. They don't break, but they can be very floppy, a bit awkward to land as soon as you put a landing net handle on. And I think that's what you get with a cheaper landing net handle, isn't it? The flop, the droop, the awkwardness to use it. And as you pay more, you get a stiffer, like you do with a pole, you get a stiffer product. Now this, I think, is an absolutely brilliant. It's really quite stiff. It's, I said, two threads. It feels strong. It's got a nice finish to get through your hands when you're trying to net fish.
Okay, so you've got the end thread on it to use it as three section, 4 meter pole for kind of match waters, your silverfish.
Can be used as that.
So two proper strong sections for your power fishing.
Exactly. You get your throds in it. So it's got the integration. You can use it as that. You can put that on the end and use it longer. You can use it without, whatever suits for the distance that you need to
net fish.
What
sort of price are we talking?
70 quid. I think the 70 quid, I think it's a really good product. I think it's, I've seen handles in the past at that price and they're not as stiff as that. And I think it's really, really good. The length of it as well, I think it gives you that versatility. I don't think there's many venues where you're gonna need much more than that, particularly if you fish on commercials. But if you did, they do a 1.5 meter extension, so that'll take it over 5 meters. But then you're looking at niche venues, maybe somewhere like the rivers high with high banks, maybe something like Bristol Docks or something like that, or maybe on the Gloucester Canal, you've got a really high drop on certain areas.
Like I said, that's quite specialist. That's why I haven't included it as standard. There's not many people that are going to need that sort of handle.
That is the same price as the landing net handle, so that's another 70 quid, which you might. I did the same myself. You instantly think, hang on, I'm getting a full landing net handle for 70 quid, but then I'm getting an extension. But then we have to start thinking about it as, well, if you buy a pole, the fourth section is more expensive than the three, than the fifth. Yes. And as you go up, there's more carbon in it.
So look at the amount of carbon you've got in that compared to kind of this. It's
straight away.
It's huge.
It goes on the tournament pro handles, all the aerity handles as well. So it's a really versatile tool. I mean, if you've spent the money on an aerity or a tournament, you're probably really serious about your fishing. And you know what? Yeah. You would go pay that extra money for it.
And if every now and again you just want that extra handle, well, you can do that relatively cheaply with a cheaper extension to what's already a very expensive top end handle. So nice.
Exactly. Nice. And I think for 70 quid, I think they'll sell plenty because, as I said, it's as you go up the ladder, I think landing handles get better, get stiffer. And for me, that's a real winner. And I'm pretty sure Daiwa are going to sell a few of them.
Very nice. Shall I show you what I've got?
Yes. Next.
Right. It's high pressure. The sun shines out, we want to be shallow fishing, don't we? Shallow fishing on the pole, it's fun, but whilst you're doing it, you're wishing you were fishing a waggler, weren't you?
Oh, pellet waggler.
And this isn't just a pellet waggler rod, this is a very top-end one. This is the brand new Preston Innovations Supera X pellet waggler, so it's absolutely as top as you're going to get. Andy Powers had a big say in the design of this rod.
Gives you instant confidence.
Yeah, we're looking at around about £250. You can pick up one of these for 11 foot long, which quite interesting in the pellet waggler rods. That was always something that people didn't spend an awful lot on. because you didn't need to. It's an 11 foot shorter rod. As long as it's soft enough with the cheaper carbon to play fish, it didn't really matter. But as time's gone on, the pellet waggler's developed, the fish have wised up more to it, and people are looking to spend more and more money on their pellet waggler rods. So what you get with this is, not only is it lovely and thin, it's fantastically soft for playing the fish, but the recovery on it is very, very fast. Because we're striking at bites now on the pellet waggler. You want the pellet waggler to land, you want a nice straight line to it, and you want a very, very fast recovery to hit those bites square on. The days of chucking the rod down like that and just going and waiting for the rod to rip round, they're long gone. Hence the need for these sophisticated high-end products.
And we're at the Glebe on Lake 3 today, and you, this is one of the primary reasons we've come here today, to play with that. And you've had, I mean, this place is renowned for hard fighting fish, isn't it?
Yeah.
They are absolute torpedoes, and you've had five or six now between sort of 6 and 10 pound, and no issues. It's been a drill. Yeah. I've just been watching it, and you can see the blend of that finesse with that power. It just seems to tick the boxes.
Well, the interesting thing is, over 2 hours I've fished with it so far, I've had five fish, but that's only been 8 bites.
Yeah.
That's not a lot of bites. If you haven't got everything absolutely bang on right, that could very easily have been 8 missed bites, not a single fish.
Yeah, absolutely. Right. And it seemed, when I was watching you play fish before, that if the rod was too soft and you're pulling into these torpedoes, the rod could just keep bending and bending. It seems to have a point where it almost kind of locks up naturally to give you that, you know, that little bit of grunt. It doesn't just keep bending. It doesn't just keep going. Yeah. It keeps a nice shape. It keeps a nice action when them fish are pulling, and it just gives you, I said, the backbone here, the finesse to deliver it. That's when I'm watching you, that's the way it seemed.
Yeah, it's a very, very manageable action. It's obviously soft at the start. It just stiffens and stiffens and stiffens. Even at the point where you're almost kind of saying it is locked up, it kind of feels like it's almost just got that little tiny bit more, just that last bit that's going to stop your line from breaking and just give you that cushioning action.
I mean, you mentioned the price, 250 quid. Mm. Some people will say, that's a lot of money. Worth the money though? Because you pay big money for the best. What do you think?
If you do that sort of fishing, then absolutely. If you don't do that sort of fishing, you don't do it very often, or you just want to try the pellet waggler every now and again, you know, go for a 50 quid rod, 60 quid rod, 80 quid, whatever you want. However, if you're going to do a lot of it, you're competing in competitions, you want the best, then you're going to pay for this. And I'll tell you what, you're certainly not going to regret it. Absolutely beautiful tool.
That's what you'd expect from the superior range, isn't it? Lovely.
Have you got another product for us?
I have indeed. I have indeed. I'm conscious, you know, we're conscious sometimes. We're quite matchy, aren't we, in what we do, you know, in our fishing. But obviously, not everyone who watches will be like that. So every now and then, pick a product that, like, if we're being honest, it's a bit out of our comfort zone. We may not use it ourselves, but you look at it and you're speaking to anglers, you think that could tick the box. And this is the next one. So these are new boilies from Dynamite. They're the hot crab and krill.
Yeah.
Now these go in, I think it's 15 mil, 20 mil and 26 mil.
Yeah.
I mean, we've been using 8 mil pellets today and we're going, they're big pellets. So you can tell we're a bit matchy. So these are a bit animal for us. But the amount of river anglers you speak to, there's so many big fish in the rivers, barbel and carp.
Yeah.
And they're the specific things they want to catch. There's a lot of bream, which you and I would love to catch, but they don't want to catch the bream. And bream can seem to eat anything. These 20 mil boilies are up to 26 mil as well. And in a flavour which just seems, I don't know, them fishy krill type things seem to be the rage at the moment, aren't they?
Well, hot crab and krill, that's as, you know, in focus as it's ever going to get. You know, everyone's on the krill, those spicy flavours. Let's have a look at the size of those boilies, though. They are
proper, aren't they? I know.
They're massive.
They're eye-watering, but they say they're doing an even bigger size. And you can see, you know, if you're waiting, when you get that bite, you want it to be the double-figure barbel and not a 3 pound bream in the middle of the night. Something like that could just make sure that bite is that big fish.
At 2 a.m, if you get a screaming run, you've been woken up from your bivvy, you hop outside, you don't want it to be a 5 pound bream, do you?
No, you don't. And I know the few of you will be watching saying, yes, bream can get their mouths around anything, but still, it will reduce the chances. And I think something with so much scent, so much flavour, you put that in the current, and you know, it's gonna ooze flavour off. And it's just something worth trying. They caught my eye, and I think if you're into that style of fishing, then you know, you can thank me for your personal best.
I love the fact we've even got the little flakes of chilli loose inside the packet, and you can see them poking out from the boilies themselves. So, should we try one in a little bit? Do you want to?
We'll toss a coin who does it, yeah?
Right, okay.
We'll toss a coin.
We'll have a glass of milk ready.
Definitely, without a doubt.
Flyer.
Yes.
My next choice is also bait, and it's the Ringers Dark Cocoa, which... it's still the original Ringers Dark, which everyone loves. However, there's a slightly sweet and also active element that's been added. So anyone that followed the Ringers team last year, the feeder team, they had an absolutely awesome year. They won about everything
on fire,
going, didn't they? Was it on the Trent Rudyard Lake? This was actually the mix that they
And that was before it was released, wasn't it?
Yes. Yeah, it was, but they didn't really want it to be released. You know, they were catching so many
unlucky
fish on
lads.
It. But,
unlucky.
It just got to the point where Phil decided, well, my job's selling ground bait.
I can't
have this under my hat any longer. And I've actually given this a go as well. Usually, we get a product sent through. I was very lucky. Phil actually dropped 7 bags off to me. So
you said you've given it a go. Let's expand on having given it a go, because here's some proof in the pudding.
I gave it a go at Ferry Meadows. That was my first bag. I had a cracking day with £27 on a Feeder Masters qualifier. I was one fish short of winning my section on that. A little bit annoying. I've been down to Upper Tamar Lakes fishing a festival down there. I used it 6 days running, caught loads of fish, really enjoyed myself. And then more recently, I've just got back from there. I fished the Feeder King qualifier at Southfield. I finished 4th in the match, won my zone, and I've qualified for the Feeder King final doing it. So, I haven't got many of those 7 bags left. So, Phil, if you're watching, I'm really enjoying this. It's this mix,
and that's not an easy place to go and win, mate. Like, that's you know, you've got that Southfield. I've always got the feeling when you speak to people, those fine details, getting your mix right, getting, you know, all those little things. If you don't have the right mix, you could be. I mean, what was your weight at Southfield? Sorry,
oh, it wasn't a lot, it was only 12 pounds, something like that. And eight fish,
one fish less, you could have fallen out there easily. And you know, you're dragging an odd fish in, and it says a lot. Steve, I've always found Steve Ringer to be very honest with things. He genuinely, he doesn't, you know, blow the trumpet of a product that he doesn't believe in. I've seen him on social media genuinely saying that's, I think, I might misquote him here slightly, but I'm sure he said it's one of his favourite ground baits ever, if not ever. I've seen him raving about it, and he's not the sort of person who would do that if he didn't believe in it.
It's a best of both mix. You know, the strong fish meal, that appeals to the big fish. But however, we've got this sweet additive which draws in the smaller fish as well, and also the activity, you know, you get the little bit of fizz and movement, which got to beware doing that. It is so active, if you just literally just mix it nice and dry and light and give it a squeeze, it's actually going to float. So either mix it well in advance so the particles absorb fully, or in fact what I do, I actually measure out the water that I'm going to put in it, really saturate it, let it dry out a little bit, make sure everything's fully soaked, and that gets around it as well. So very good as it is, a little bit of thought needs to go into the
It's like any ground bait, though. There's always a formula of the amount of water that gets it to its peak, isn't there? And it's just knowing that, isn't it? It's knowing that, and it's using it correctly. You know, there's certain ground baits which are best overwetted and take lots on, some don't. And it's just knowing that formula. And once you click onto that, you get the best out of it, don't you?
If anyone wants to give this a try, what I've found is, again, any kind of measuring container, a 1-pint bait box is ideal. Measure out 2 parts of this ground bait into a bowl, add 1 part water, you mix the whole lot, it looks like a sloppy stodge, you think you've ruined it. However, 10 minutes later, it's dried out perfectly, just run it through a riddle and it's ready to go. So 2 parts ground bait, 1 part water, love it.
And what you've obviously used that for silverfish, any use on commercials as well?
Oh yeah, absolutely. It's the strength of the fish meal that's in this. I'll say it's for silverfish. It's for silverfish that are used to seeing pellets and are used to seeing a lot of fish meal. So it's a very strong fish meal mix. You'd happily use it on a venue like how we're here today. We're at the Glebe Fishery. One place where I don't think I'd use it so much is when we get into winter and the temperatures start dropping. I think the fish meal is going to be a little bit too strong, but whilst the temperatures are high and there's a lot of fish feeding, definitely a ground.
We don't mention winter. We don't mention winter.
Not at the minute.
Let's not talk about it. We'll edit that bit out, but that sounds like a real winner. It really does. And again, trusted brand. You know, you look at the Ringers range, it's not as big as some others,
yeah.
But every product is proper, should we say. It has a, you know, they almost become cult. You know, I don't know how many they've got, but it's not as many as maybe some other brands. But everyone has a genuine proper use and
Phil
has genuine proper
likes
fans.
To design, it's probably not the best business sense, really, but he tends to design products for himself first before selling them, really. So, everything has that job.
Brilliant.
Have you got another product for
final
us?
Final one. And this is an expansion of a range. So this is, and I think you'll come across this somewhere, it's the DuraSlip Elastic, the hybrid from Preston. A lot of people have been using it. It's a lot cheaper than hollows. You know, it has a little bit more grunt in it, if you like, than a hollow. It's just kind of, it's a happy medium between a solid and a hollow. You know, it's that middle ground. They had grades, I think it was 5 through to 19. It's all in odd numbers. And now they've gone either end of the scale. So there's a 3, which I guess is, you know, hand-sized skimmers, silverfish, right at the bottom end.
That's your canal angler, your drain angler, your little bits and pieces angler, isn't it?
It is. Yeah. That's small fish. And then, right up, this is more intriguing. Not controversy, it's the wrong word, but I always think thick elastics get tongues wagging. Yeah. People are like, oh no, that's too thick, it's too much. These are a 21 and a 23. And you might think, stupid. But the problem is now, is people compare a modern elastic to what was a 20 solid all those years ago. They are not the same thing at all.
No, a 20 solid used to strike into a fish, it'd go and it's, me pole's going to break.
Just
with these, they've got the same kind of power to start off with, but when the fish then goes, it just keeps giving and giving and giving, and it's not anything like as frightening as those old solid elastics.
But these elastics, and I had them out just having a little stretch, that's the sort of elastic I'm pretty sure you could put through a normal carp pole, should we say.
Yeah.
Tension it appropriately. You'll hit fish. They'll take a couple of feet out, get out of your peg, which is what you want. And then when you need to do a bit of, you know, when you want to get them in quicker, it just puts you in the driving seat a little bit more. You know, they tighten up, but they're not just, like you said, they're not just, it's like you've explained about that solid. Yeah. It's not the same product. They're completely different. There's more give in these. And if you are worried about it, set it on the slack side. You can always trim it. You can always, you know, if you catch a few fish and you think you're getting run around a bit, you can always trim it. So rather than going on the tight side, leave it so when you've caught a fish, you end up with, I don't know, 6 inches hanging out the top, then just trim it, just to give you that peace of mind and work your way in.
Yeah, it's a soft and steady elastic. You don't strike like Zorro. You gently kind of lift into the fish. You guide them out before they know what's going on. If you strike like Zorro and go, try and hoover them out and that's where you're going to end
somewhere
up
like this, somewhere like this, it's perfect because you hit them big fish. And if your elastic's too light, you're getting down to a top kit and you're forever the pulling. This just puts you in, just gives you that little bit step up. And just give them a try. I said, don't knock them because of their grade straight away.
Yeah.
Give them a try. If you're in doubt, like I said, start on the 21, so the 23. If you're fishing for big fish, I'd say, I don't know, it depends on the circumstances. Maybe slightly snag a peg. Maybe you're fishing for, you know, 7 to 15 pound fish. Maybe you're on a bagging water somewhere like Todbo. You know, there's uses for it. And like it, with any elastic, you look at the circumstances and work the grade out. But these do, in my opinion, have a role in modern fishing. And I think they'll sell a few, mate.
It's a heavy, but a manageable heavy.
Exactly that. Perfect. Exactly that. Well summarised.
Well, yeah, I should get a job in angling media
or
something
really
like that,
should,
shouldn't I?
I know all the
terms and everything. But, you know, either that or in fashion magazines, if anyone's watching the older.
You could do the fashion
shorts.
And I could do the weather. Listen, if anyone's out there, we haven't got agents, but tap us up. We've got our email addresses. But that was good fun, mate. 5 again. I think hopefully you agree that we're covering a bit of everything, because that's what we try to do, don't we? Everything from bits and pieces to stuff out of our comfort zone. And as always, if you've got a product that you've seen and you want us to have a look at and run the rule over, we'll do it, won't we? People give us a heads up.
Absolutely. Now, every time I look over your shoulder, I see another carp. So let's go catch a few.
That's our time to wrap it up. Cheers, guys.
See you later. Heads.
Tails. Oh. Crack on, mate.
Oh, that is spicy as well. That is, oh, that's proper hot.